Big honor to be invited to represent here. And I just already put in the chat that it's very difficult that we don't see each other, but it feels a little bit social of distance. So I'm very happy that we can do this and that there are so many people in the audience. It's also a very big honor that I talk after Michael Fehlings, who is my example of how we can combine surgery with science. And he's one of the, I think, first neurosurgeons who promoted clinical epidemiological science and also bio basic science in neurosurgery. So again, thanks for the example. And I will discuss spine trauma, and I won't look in detail into spinal cord injury, although the reason that we do everything is to prevent patients having very severe disability after a spinal cord injury. And that's the reason why we need a classification. I talk on behalf of the spine section and neurotrauma section or committees of WFNS. I also thank Salman and Mehmet for all the work they have done until now, so that we have a global issue about these classifications. So my conflicts of interest are nearly the same like Michael. I have some commercial sponsorships, but the most important thing is that I'm also leading a quite big, large department in two cities, Leiden and The Hague. So everything I say about surgery, there might be some, well, prioritize that I am more in favor of surgery compared to conservative treatment, because that's also part of my work. And secondly, I'm also in the board of the National Health Insurance, giving sponsorship to studies. So that's also a conflict of interest. So why do we need a classification? Because what we did do was already quite good. Well, it's very important that we can discuss with each other the morphology, the neurology, and also try to interpret the intactness of the discolegomentous complex, DLC. So we want to predict prognosis, not only for the patient and his family also, but also the kind of treatment options. So which interaction and surgical approach or conservative approach is the best value for the patient. So this classification system should be descriptive, and a gradation should be based on severity. And for us all, as we are sitting here, we have insight in each other's spine trauma patients and prognostication, and help each other in treatment decisions. So when you look at etiology and mechanism, this was 20 to 30 years ago. So when we talked about spine trauma, young people, a lot of sport accidents, also traffic accidents. But currently there's changed a lot. And if I talk to the spinal cord injury patient organizations, they say, well, all your treatment algorithms are for the younger people. Well, currently we are becoming older, and in 20 years, I'm this guy trying to surf the sea in Portugal. But it might be not a good idea, but the thing is that there are more traumas in elderly. So if I look, and I don't know about all your departments, but if I look at my own department, more than 50% of our patients currently have spinal cord injury or spine fractures at an elderly age. And this is an increasing problem in our society. So we have to deal with that, and also maybe adapt our classification schemes. So this is what I showed here. I was not allowed by my trainer to use distances and angles, because he said to me, and maybe some of you recognize that, well, you are a neurosurgeon and you are not an orthopedic surgeon, so you don't want to measure angles and distances. Well, it's very important. So please all use your kind of measurements, try to have metrics to look at distances, look at angles, and also, for instance, look at kyphotic angles, because it facilitates communication between each other, even on distance. So if one of you has a very difficult spine fracture, you can call and say, well, I see this distance, I see this angulation. Currently, you can also look with the WhatsApp. It helps you in making the treatment decisions, and also helps you in follow-up. And we have to be aware that all the studies we did until now, also studies by Michael Fahlings, but also studies by Vaccaro, they looked at the classification. It is already validated in their clinics, but we didn't use it at the global level, and I'm a proponent to do that in the future. So if we look at the classification systems until now for the Cervical Spine Research Society, and recently at consensus meetings with World Federation of Neurological Societies, WFNS, about spine trauma. And if we work that way and we collect our data, it might be that we have in 5 to 10 years an enormous answer to a lot of questions. I won't go into detail in the subaxial spine because the time limit is for subaxial spine and upper C spine too much. But it's very important to look at the papers of Vaccaro and also later papers and use for the subaxial C spine the SLIC system. It looks at neurology, morphology, and also at the disco ligamentous complex. You can use the numbers, but it might also be intuitive. It's very important that if you look at the amount of neurological deficit, that a complete neurological deficit has less points than an incomplete deficit. The reason is that we hope that people can improve with an incomplete deficit. The question is that the right approach? I'm not very sure if a patient in a complete tetraplegic or paraplegic patient comes in the urgent phase and you have to decide for surgery if the acute phase is a very good phase to look at it. But that's probably for the discussion. So these WFNS recommendations, you can find them on our website. It's very important to have the approach which we use to immobilize the C-spine. Although the trauma surgeons are not using collars, we propose collars. There are certain distances which are measured metrics, like the anterior atlantodental interval of 3 millimeter. But it might be very much more importantly to look at your posterior atlantodental interval with a superior cervical spine injury. Because the posterior interval is more important for the spinal cord and also the medulla oblongata. Before placing your screws, always look at your CT scan. And if you don't have a CT scan in your neighborhood and you have to do an urgent surgery, then open up quite widely that you see your anatomy so that you put in your screws, especially in the high C-spine, being aware of a vertebral artery, which might be large on one side and occluded on the other side. So if I look at occipital condyle fractures, so that's the most upper part, in the past, we didn't see them much, and we thought that most of those patients died. Currently, with current CT scans, we see more and more fractures in the condyle. But are those important? Most of them can be treated without surgery, only conservative treatment. We do not advise cervical traction for atlanto-dental and atlanto-occipital distances. So don't use traction for those cases, because that is a big risk that you have with you traction, as you can put traction on your spinal cord or your medulla oblongata. So we propose from WFNS the Mueller classification and look at your distances, and most are conservative. But if there is a bilateral, well, you can do that and you do a craniosophical fixation. It might also be that if you have severe brain trauma and spinal cord injury, it might mean that you have an atlanto-occipital dislocation. You have to look at it, and if you suspect it, it might be better to promote surgery in early phase only in very severe cases. Well, the C1 fractures are more commonly approached. You all know them. All of you are trained in that. And it's quite easy. In the past, we used an open mouth view to look at the distances and look at the rule of Spence. if this distance A plus B, look at the lateral line of C2 and lateral line of C1. If that's more than 7 millimeter, it indicates transverse ligament rupture, and you might discuss surgery for those patients. But sometimes it's still easy to look at it at a conservative way and follow it up. But in my clinics, we use this distance. If more than 7 millimeter, we discuss instability, risk of neurological deficit, and we are having low threshold for doing surgery. Most atlas fractures don't have a ligament rupture of the transverse ligament and can be treated without surgery. So this is a diagram of the algorithm of isolated atlas fractures, and there's consensus that if it is intact, you don't need to have surgery. You can have a Philadelphia collar, sometimes a SOMI brace. I nearly never use them for C2 fractures. Halo braces are used still worldwide quite widely. We don't use it, a halo brace, because we think it makes a lot of patients worse, but it can be a good idea for some patients. If I need a halo brace, for instance, in this group, then I go for surgery, going for C1, C2 fusion. Sometimes you can do a direct C1 fusion and connect the fracture lines by compression of a rod in this area. So then we can go to the odontoid fractures, a little bit lower. And this is one of the fractures which we see more and more commonly in the elderly. And that's also part of a big study we are now running in Europe, looking at those different fractures. So the type 1, type 2, and type 3, I don't have to explain them to all of you because you know it. The type 3 is quite important because it's a large area where you have feeding of arterial vessels. So there's a good consolidation possibility. But some type 3 fractures are still type 2 fractures. I come back to that later. So a type 1, it is say in the CSRS, that's saying SOMI or halo brace, but I would say collar, or even in a very old patient, not even a collar, but that might be disputable. We can discuss that. In type 2, it's saying less than 6 millimeters density placements. It is saying a halo brace. In my clinic, we do an anterior dense access at that moment. So maybe we are too aggressive. And if there's big displacement, then open reduction and in-situ fusion. And at type 3, it's saying halo brace. And in our clinic, it's a collar or a SOMI brace. What's quite important, also recommended by WFNS, to use the classification of Grauer, in which there are different types of type 2 fractures, A, B, C. And for instance, this fracture can be very good amendable for an anterior dense access. Whereas this fracture looks like a type 3 fracture. But be careful, because it can also be a type 2 class C with a fracture line to this difficult vascular, low vascular zone, in which there's a high risk of pseudoarthrosis, malunion. So then if you look at these unstable fractures, it is with an intact transverse ligament to do an anterior dense fixation, anterior dense access. If it is not intact, it doesn't have any sense to do an anterior dense access screw fixation, because you create C1, C2 instability, and it might even become worse if you put in your screw. So if it is disrupted, do a C1, C2 fusion, and you can depend on what is your training and your amendability, how you do this C1, C2 fusions. Most of us use a posterior approach. Some people use an anterior approach to do direct C1, C2 fixation. So one example of and warning, if you treat patients with a type 2 fracture wrongly and there is pseudoarthrosis, you can also create kyphosis. So this is an instance, for instance, in my country, in which a patient was not treated well and she came with swallowing problems, and she told that she had a type 2 fracture. She didn't tell us she had a type 2 fracture. She told us she had a trauma, and she was treated by a neck fracture. And that fracture was not followed up. And she came with swallowing problems because of the hyperlordosis. But the most important problem is she was walking very badly, and she had this kyphotic deformity and a wrongly fused segment at the upper C-spine. So if you have this one, you need big surgery with a lot of risks, high amount of instability with needs craniovascular fusion. So it's only a warning. We don't see it often, but we see it still too much, because every case in which it could be prevented is better to prevent than to perform this kind of surgery. So most of you might be aware and are trained in your clinics, but we see that a lot of people are still a little bit afraid for the anterior dense access. I'm using navigation currently, but I'm also using the C-arm. So I'm not only using the navigation CT scan, but also anterior dense access X-ray. And the positioning of the patient is more important and even more difficult than the surgery itself. With a very good positioning, extended X-ray, good position, also AP view with a pillow under the shoulders. If the position is good, and it takes a while, I know, and people are getting impatient to do that, but if you have a good position, it's quite good to do the anterior dense access. If you didn't position well, then you see a lot of failures. And you have to take aware if people have a very high thoracic cage sternum, that it also might be difficult to put in your screw. The mouth gag is for your anterior view. It's also important for your CT navigation if you use that. We are used to the Brown Esculap anterior dense access, which was demonstrated by Apfelbaum earlier. This is for the blade to push away the base of the tongue, and then you can enter this, and you can see that in the books. First drill the upper part of C3 and then go to C2. It looks easy, but if you are not trained, it gives you difficulties. So these are those instruments. Very important if you put in your screw that you have your position of your hands the other way around, because you have otherwise the thoracic cavity. You enter it first with a key wire, and after that, you have to drill through and through. And mostly I use bicortical aperture CA2, but it's not necessary in all cases. So there's a lot of discussion going on, because I know that Dr. Apfelbaum was always using two screws. He's propagating that, and a lot of other people also. Well, I don't see any evidence in favor of two screws. So sometimes I use two screws if one screw is not good. So if a screw is malpositioned, I use a second screw. But if the screw is in a good direction, I use one screw. So, but dense access problems exist. Also in our clinics, we see those problems like this breaking of a screw, bad position of the screw, and even this, which I plucked from the internet, but we also had the same in an old lady. She was the mother of two lawyers. So don't do that in the mother of two lawyers, these kind of dense access, because if this fails, then you have a big problem afterwards. So if you expect dense access problems, or if you live in an area where you don't have people doing anterior dense access in your clinic, then do a direct C1, C2 fixation or a Margrel fixation. We all know that the first one was not a harms, but Professor Goel from India who promoted C1, C2 fixation, and Professor Harms adapted it. Well, currently you can use this in young people to do a C1, C2 fixation and remove it after 6 months, hopefully that you keep your rotation, because one of the big drawbacks you all know is that if you do a posterior fixation, you lose your rotation. In my hands, I still feel comfortable if I don't want to put out the screws in 6 months or 1 year to do the transarticular C1, C2 fixation as described by Margrel. It's depending on the amount of training. So I always say, well, this is the most stable fixation. I can use it with X-ray, because you can also, what you see here is the navigated part. So this is navigated, cannulated wire in which you have one, your navigation, but also your X-ray in one screen. So it is, in my opinion, safe if you are trained well. And it might be superior to harms or wires, but to be honest, after dense fractures with a good harms fixation or gold harms fixation, it's good enough. Wires I only use as an add-on to use to put in the bone. Currently, this is my personal opinion, not very much evidence-based. So if you do these kind of fixations, be aware beforehand on your CT scan, look at your vertebral artery. If there's a high riding vertebral artery like this patient, don't try to put in a screw here. Just do this one and do a direct C1, C2, or in this patient in which there were other problems, do a big fixation. So if you go for the odontary fractures and recommendations, in adult patients, ADI is important, but as I said earlier, the PADI, posterior atlantic dental interval, might also be more important. If the odontary fracture is more than 4 millimeters displaced, there's a high risk of fracture non-union. So you should have a surgical fixation in your armatorium. But again, in my clinic and also in other clinics, there's discussion in a very old one, the octogenarians of older than 80. And that's not the topic of this presentation. We do a study and we are currently less aggressive in the very old. Also because they don't play football anymore. And that's also an important thing. Then Hangman's fractures, you all know them. It's quite easy to treat type 1 fracture. Maybe we use a collar, but maybe no collar is also possible. Type 2 fracture needs to be treated very carefully. Some use it conservatively and some surgery. This is very old-fashioned picture, but I don't use it anymore. I do know that some clinics still use traction to arrange very good control and to have this kind of position. We are more in the use of phase surgery. Currently, I never use one screw. If there's one screw necessary, you can also do it conservatively. So mostly, in our case, there are C2, C3 fixations. Is everything going well in our clinic? No, not very well. This is a very unstable trauma patient, intubated, and one of my colleagues put in traction on this patient. And this is what you see. So that's a little bit crazy in a hangman's fracture. So what is happening here? So traction was left alone, halo, construction was done, and this patient needed surgery before and after. This was the type 2A, in which the trauma mechanism is distraction. So it's flexion, distraction, compression, action, and disflexion, instead of the other compression fracture in hangman's fracture. So type 2A is a dangerous one. And if you use the halo vest, for instance, in my patient, it was a huge guy like my buddy, and he had a vena cava superior syndrome. So summarize, hangman's fractures, type 3 never occur in our clinics. We only saw one and the patient died. Type 2, if I need a halo brace, in our clinic we use surgery, but halo brace might be a very good option. And I know that some trauma centers use it. If it's irreducible, you need to do surgery. And if you are not used in this kind of surgery, then refer the patient to a clinic where you can do that. So these are the WFNS recommendations. We had a lot of discussion about this one, the upright X-ray and the medical supervision may be useful besides CT scan, but there was consensus to do that. For a Levine type 2A hangman's fracture, surgery is recommended. This was an expert opinion. We discussed it and there were people pro and people con, but in the end, there was consensus that it needs surgery. And a type 3, if you see that, it might require both anterior and posterior surgery. And constant treatment, not with a hilo vest. So some people agree with us, but because of its complications. So the same is true for a WFNS recommendation for combined atlas and axial fractures, surgical treatment in case there's huge displacement of more than 5 millimeters. So again, for traction, please be careful, please be aware. This is a patient in our clinic, not treated by myself.
Wilco, please unmute. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Was I mute? So that was nearly my last slide. One last sentence from my side, advice. We are surgeons. We are looking at our fractures, but sometimes we forget that behind the fracture, there's a spinal cord injury and there's a patient, and the patient is a human being. And I like to advise you all to go back to your clinics and think about the follow-up. Thank you very much.